Henry Moore has lived and worked in this very English setting of gardens, fields and woods for nearly 40 years. Moore was the first to open my eyes to sculpture, and perhaps I still see it through his eyes. I think of it as a very practical and a very human art. Moore is one of a handful of people in Europe who gave modern sculpture a new standing. There has always been, and there always will be, a respectable body of sculptors who make monuments and statues and portraits of their sitters. But Moore was one of the very few men in the 20th century to revive a dormant form of European art and turn it into something that had all the power and freedom of expression that modern painting had already discovered. The man who shaped the hard substances of stone and bronze and wood and made them into majestic and monumental interpretations of the human figure is now the most famous living sculptor in the Western world. He is a Yorkshireman, single-minded, resourceful and resolute. And those are the qualities which have sustained his enduring achievement. When Moore began his studies at the Leeds School of Art, he was the only student of sculpture there. At his first exhibition, it was mostly his drawings that sold at £1 each, and for 20 years he earned his living by teaching. A sculptor's life in England has never been an easy one. The first dealer to promote his work outside England was a German, Kurt Valentin, and it was in Italy, at the Venice Biennale in 1948, that Moore won the prize for sculpture that established his worldwide reputation. Even now, Moore sells three-quarters of his work abroad, mostly in America. But no one could be more English by temperament and cast of mind.
Just on the turn of the grain, really. This isn't the place for chiselling. John, if you can put that just somewhere on the side. It's got a better... No, right round. All right, turn it over again. There. Oh, right. I'll bring it over here. I'll bring it in for that. Sit there.
Oh, yeah. Look, that will be better when you're out of the way. You're standing in the light. There you are.
Now, when I went to see him, as his 80th birthday approached, I found him as eager to talk about his beliefs as ever. He is, amongst other things, a meticulous photographer of his own work and attends to every detail with almost boyish enthusiasm.
I don't want that white edge at the back. It comes to that edge. There. That doesn't matter about having any sharp edge. There we are. Now, see, that'll make a much better. There.
In 57 years, he's made about 800 sculptures. I am a sculptor, he told me, because I want to make things real. Drawing is also a way of making things real, and what Moore draws is, to anyone who only knows his sculpture, a matter of constant surprise. He's made 4,000 sketches and drawings of various kinds, and well over 400 etchings and lithographs. Now, to me, a work of art remains a work of art, regardless of its size or its cost in time and labour. I see no reason to suppose that a drawing, done in a few minutes, is of any less interest than a sculpture weighing many tons. Moore's drawings reveal the working of his mind. They are at the heart of his genius. They are his only way of keeping pace with the fertility of his imagination. Not long ago, I saw an etching by Moore, which seemed to me to be something entirely new in his work. I was astonished to discover the inspiration for it in a sketchbook dated 1926. There he jotted down something that he'd seen at a circus during a holiday in France more than half a century ago. He's like an elephant that never forgets. He can draw inspiration either from immediate experience or from impressions recorded years ago. For example, in 1925, he saw a photograph of an Etruscan sculpture of the 3rd century BC. He based this drawing on it. This willingness to learn came from his upbringing as the 7th of 8 children in a Yorkshire mining family. Education and self-improvement were taken as a matter of course. Two sisters and one brother became teachers.
This was the most straightforward way to win a scholarship from the elementary school, go to the grammar school, take the Cambridge senior exam, as it was then called, and get into university or training college and become a teacher. This was a straightforward way for working class mining town sons to get out of the rut of coal mining. And I think that was the most miserable time of my life, of having to teach, because the children, I mean, I was too young to know when they were going to make fun of one and pull one's leg and do their little stunts. And it was a mixed school that I taught in. The girls were infinitely worse than the boys. They knew just how to make a boy of 17 embarrassed in all sorts of ways. And they'd weep and cry and so on into the...
At first sight, Moore's desk, in the corner of his graphics studio, seems to be a litter of unconnected odds and ends. In fact, everything there gives a clue to his tastes and his interests. Some freshly modelled figures caught my eye. Surely I'd seen them somewhere before. Moore owns a small sketch by Cézanne, which is a study for one of the famous paintings of bathers. He's inordinately fond of it. Not everyone shares Moore's enthusiasm for Cézanne's bulky and stylized figures, but Moore sees them in a way a sculptor looks at things. In his eyes, they are convincing and expressive statements. As drawings, they are bound to work if they were ever to be used as a basis for sculptures.
So I said to friends when we've been admiring this, that I could easily make each of those three figures into sculpture. That to me, they're completely realized, and I spent a morning doing that. I've cast them into plaster since, and I've worked them as figures completely, and to me, that's just as real as this side, which Cézanne happened to draw. And what I intend doing is to photograph them from the other side, just to prove that they are really in space.
It was not difficult to find a relationship between the Cézanne figures on the desk, the Degas reproductions on his shelf, and Moore's own love of massive forms.
Degas, undoubtedly, is a marvellous figure draftsman. And I think those are just the leaflets advertising a new book on Degas and showing the quality of the reproductions, which came perhaps last week. And when something like that comes of interest, I just put it on the desk where I'm working, and it may stay there for a year, or it may be removed and something else in its place within a day or two. But again, you see, I mean, the back view of the bather bending down is the same kind of big monumental realization of the figure that there is in the Cézanne.
Moore has never been a purely abstract artist. His feelings and his intellect have always been guided by a preference for the human figure. This is not difficult to trace to the early experiences of childhood, and Moore can still remember the way he used to rub his mother's back to relieve her rheumatism.
I was embarrassed, but I knew all in her back, where the shoulder blades came, where the backbone, where the soft part. This was something that, as a boy of 7 or 8, when there was no one else, she would ask me to rub her back. And this, perhaps, as I did, it reminds one of one's. It's a most sculptural, simple sculptural part of the body, the human body. Backs are things that I love and come easily. It may be from that rubbing of my mother's back as a boy.
Another picture pinned up by his desk was a copy of a drawing by the German artist Albrecht Dürer, who was born in 1471.
Well, the Dürer this again, the form is unbelievably tactile and realised. So much so that in looking at it, I suddenly felt that I could make a landscape out of the, look at the ridge in the nose there coming down, the great big sweep of a hill coming down, this great big dip and valley, then here could be a waterway. And I made a little copy, a quick copy one day of this, and tried to turn some of this part into a landscape with all the forms. And this is Surah's mother knitting or doing embroidery. And Surah's attitude to drawing became quite different from the Dura, which is using line to give you a sense of perspective in the form. Here, Surah draws purely by light, and he makes light give you the shape which comes out of a darkness. Now, I was reminded of this way of drawing when I did the coal mine drawings in Yorkshire, because in the coal mine, darkness is the reality. And so it's light that reveals the form. And this, you see, all here is a kind of mystery and darkness. And Surah drew in this kind of way at the very end of his life, of making light come off the paper, whereas the other way of drawing is to put darkness on the paper. He's a wonderful draftsman again.
Rembrandt is another of Moore's heroes. He has this small etching by him.
The etchings are marvellously worked out in reality and in detail. But in the sketches, often he had a kind of shorthand method of expressing things in his mind, which to other people may not mean anything. For instance, if you turn that over and covered up the fact of a face, nobody would understand. It is purely abstract calligraphy, seen from that point of view, better, in my opinion, than the Chinese or Japanese calligraphy. There was this calligraphic pleasure that Rembrandt had, and the handling, which is marvellous too. 4 or 5 years ago, after looking and admiring a book of Rembrandt's drawings, I wanted to try out myself whether I understood this kind of calligraphy interpretation. And in a sketchbook I began, and this perhaps is a little bit an imitation of the calligraphy here. But I did other pages. Now this began like that. Here is what seems to be. But later I turned it to see whether I could do what Rembrandt does here, by identifying parts of your drawing. The others can have a meaning, and I turned what had been calligraphy like that into that scene. And I went on with the sketchbook. This began in the same way, like that, and then with Rembrandt in my mind, I turned it into this complete drawing, which is very much Rembrandt, or at least influenced. Here again, a more of the same calligraphic. And I turned, this began it too. You can see the strong marks, and one turned it into this picture of a man fishing. Here, this began in that part, and again, one by covering up, it was a, but I added the form into it afterwards. And so it went on. There was another. These were purely without the head and all these are influenced by the Rembrandt technique. There's another start, which wasn't carried on with. This one was. It began in here, and became another scene. this began with just, I think, that line there. And then one added all this other and made it. Because it's only following what Leonardo said, that an artist should be able to find in the lichen marks on a wall a wonderful landscape. But of course, I mean, Leonardo would have found a much better landscape than a third-rate artist would have found. Here's the drawing we were talking about earlier of the Dürer. And if I began, I mean, I could be drawing this or drawing it from life, and I could think there with the nose, I'm going across the a section across there, if that was sliced and I were looking at it, then I'm going to come down it, and I could go this way and round that, then I could come across, that is, I could go down here, round, over, over, down, over, but you can't go diagonally, otherwise there's no logic. I mean, you must interpret the drawing as being sections, section lines, horizontally through it or vertically through it. I'll show you what I mean. Here, I'm beginning there, on the nose there, and I'm going over it there, down it here, along it along here, down there. Now then, I'm going to change my direction and go upwards and around the section. I'm now going to go around the eye. I'm going across, over the little bit of eyelid, over, up, across there, over the top, down the, what's it, come across this, round into this, go over the section into the jaw, down across, cross down here, round and down, cross with this, so on, and I'm drawing section lines in my mind without the, I'm coming back to this so that it makes it more obvious, the one. Here I'm going down the nose, down here. Here I'm going down the nose, down it, up over it, into it, round there, down, across, into it, down to the lip. But I've got down here with the other, down across, and over here, down the lip, into it, cross it, down, over the little chin. I come across here, round, and so on. And if I go on with this long enough, you'll get a picture of the face. But it would take, what, 10 minutes to finish the... and it's the... if one begins to put the features where they might be in it, you'll get an idea of what it is. I mean, there, once you put the eye in there, and the eye in here, it begins to be this face. With the down here, begins to be, if you get that, begins to be this head. But it's all been drawn by section line.
Drawing played a big part in Moore's early training. He did it and taught it for 20 years. This portrait of an art school model is one of the earliest of his drawings and was made in 1921. He was still using traditional methods of academic shading. Only the eyes gave real life to the picture. In the same year, he did this drawing of a girl, but his method had already changed. In place of conventional shading with a pencil, he was beginning to use watercolour and adding vigorous strokes with a pen. By the following year, he was beginning to describe the human figure with lines that followed the contours of the model across the torso and along the limbs. In the 1920s, he often went to Paris with a painter friend, and together they attended a special kind of drawing class, which encouraged rapid observation and spontaneity.
We'd buy what you could do, a book of tickets, 12 tickets for a franc each, and this allowed you to go and have free entry into a croquet class, which was a drawing class for 2 hours, where there'd be a model, no teaching, and you sat in a kind of like the gods in a sloping, and the model was in on a platform in front. And often with those, the session would begin with an hour's pose, when the model would pose for an hour, then it would be a half hour, and the last half hour of it would be divided up into probably two 5-minute ones, then 2 3-minute ones, and then 10 1-minute ones, making up the hour. By the end of the session of that, I could sometimes put my pencil down and wait for it to change for the next one. I'd done all, I'd finished it. That's of no use to you, really, except just a kind of facility with a... But this is one of them, and I'm sure that's one of the one-minute ones.
By 1928, Moore had given up academic methods altogether. He was now the master of a personal style, which he could use in any way he liked, to give his drawings those powerful and monumental qualities he felt to be in the nature of the human figure. His subjects were shaped by the structures and tensions within their forms. They were like mountains.
Mediums, whatever you use, you do anything, your thumb, anything to arrive at, so that you could interpret that afterwards. Probably I use colour on this, I've forgotten it. You must be able to guess the right proportions, otherwise you won't. I mean, your eye has to be a correct eye. You must know whether a thing is too black or too light, but it isn't the black and the lightness, and it isn't the... You've got to think of it as form. You've got to use perspective, which a thing that comes nearer to you is bigger than a thing that's further away. And often with students drawing a figure like me drawing you, they'll make, instead of making your foot and knee a bigger in proportion, it would be the same kind of length to it that it would be if you were standing up and all in the same plane. All those kind of things are things that one learns only by a lot of thinking. I mean, again, people think that artists are people that work by for pleasure, by instinct, and without ever using their minds. There's a big an intellectual effort in learning to draw properly, which Leonardo showed it and Michelangelo showed it. Those had great intellects. It isn't a God-given gift to everybody that they can just draw. All our judgments of architecture, of form, and everything else are based on the fact that we're human beings of the shape we are, and that we have a height of average between 5'6" and 6 feet, that we walk on two legs, that we have bones inside us, and that we can move in certain ways and not in other ways, that we understand from ourselves and from our mothers to begin with softness and hardness. All this, and if you don't learn from your own body, you'll learn from nothing. And that, for me, that the human body is the basis of all sense of form that all of us have. We learn how far a thing is away from us as a child by trying to touch the toy in the pram. We learn what is upright and so on because we ourselves. If we were like horses and could go to sleep on all fours, all our architecture, all our art would be different. Of course it would.
In the years between the two world wars, Moore's drawings were a means of giving shape to the ideas that he wanted to consider for sculpture. He eventually developed a rapid way of placing his ideas in a spatial and atmospheric setting by painting washes of colour over figures drawn with water-resistant wax crayons.
The wax resistance came from using my nephew, niece's Woolworth wax crayons for doing some drawings, and using watercolour as well, and finding that the watercolour didn't stay on where the wax was, but only on the background. It immediately made a background possible, which had a space sense, a spatial sense, and wasn't the flat paper. And in a drawing, if you destroy the flat surface of the paper, you can then make forms that have something behind them. And using this resist surface and then using a watercolour made the background not flat, but with distance in it, the big advantage, and the speedy way of doing it.
In September 1939, Moore was living in Kent, in the south of England, near the cliffs of Dover. He made this drawing on the day when the first air raid alarm was sounded.
And suddenly, when the hooter went, which they set off because soon after this declaration, that the sirens were sounded, as I think, to make people know, to announce that it had happened, because there wasn't a raid or anything. But we were all supposed that had all been told that we should wear gas masks, and should be, but when I don't know that we had a gas mask or so on. So I imagined all the people that were in the sea and bathing with gas masks. And this was a drawing I did that evening when I got cliffs behind than the people. And I invented different kind of masks, which is, that's all, it's amusing.
He became an official war artist. He now had a studio in London, but it was impossible to carry on with sculpture for long. For the first time in his life, drawing became a necessity. There was nothing else to do. In the First War, he'd served as a soldier, too young to make any artistic comment on his experience. Now, he saw the civilian side of modern war, and this was something entirely new. He began to draw the extraordinary scenes that he found at night as the people slept and sheltered in the deep tunnels of the London Underground Railway.
If there was something that attracted or that I thought was interesting, I'd have to make a surreptitious note in a little notebook I had. In the first case, it was just on an envelope. And then next day, when the sight, the scene was fresh in one's mind, I had a notebook, which is this, and I began drawing the ideas, and this is one of the first of them. Seeing the people in an extension which hadn't been filled in, the people all in crowds, people were all lying down, and one of my favorite subjects is a reclining figure. The whole thing was made for a Henry Moore reclining figure. Anyhow, I got very excited, very interested, and occasionally one would have to make just notes for here, instances, figures lying against platform with great bales of paper, that's not in this one, but things that I'd seen, and I made a note. This one is the extension to Liverpool Street station, which had not had lines, the railway lines put in for the tube trains, and people were just lying on each side, and the kind of tunnel-like atmosphere, and this is the first of the so-called tube shelter perspectives. That's another one, a different, slightly different version. And the perspective in each of them is a little different. I mean, that is a lower one. This is looking down more on it. And these sometimes became the basis of the bigger drawing which I made for the official war artists. One imagined that perhaps there'd never been scenes like that, so general, except perhaps when the slaves were all being exported from Africa to America in the holds of slave ships. People would be all crowded together like that, probably. And so the sketchbook went on. Here's just a group that interested me, and I tried to make the group of three. Sometimes, like in this, I was trying to make two people there seem as though they were sculpture or in a tomb, because down below it did feel sometimes like a tomb. So occasionally my sculptural interests come into it, and I may distort figures or change them for sculpture purposes. But ordinarily it was me trying to record the experiences that one had, because it was intensely human. There was even humour and so on occasionally. It was a very... here there are distortions in a way, like the thinness of the legs and the pointedness that they are, to give, well, or something, well, not consciously, but sometimes pointed forms give a kind of sense of fear, which other forms don't. Then came a period when the authorities realized that they had to organize the underground. And this is the time when they began putting in bunks for people and their children to sleep in, and to house more people on the platforms. Gave more room than people just lying at right angles to the train. I'd been doing shelter drawings for a year or so now. I'd seen and I'd experienced a great deal, and the organization began to be so controlled that more individual things in the shelter, not the whole scene, but of people, ornamental one, interest one. And here, sleeping figures, more individualized. Here. Sometimes people would hold their hands like this as though they were pulling apart. Sometimes there'd be a tension. Sometimes there'd be a rest sense, as in here, with the lower figure. Those are different positions of the figure which I could use. And which made me, because these attitudes of people sleeping, in sleep there sometimes comes a kind of abandoned angularity in how people put their hands over their heads, what in the kind of restless sleep they'll twist and turn. And this is sometimes what one's trying to get that disturbed sleep. This was probably just making a quick idea of the kind of rhythm that blankets or the sheets over people might make. I began later, after the war, to use drapery in my sculpture, which I'd never done before, or which I'd avoided doing. But then I found how drapery could give you a mysterious double guess at what the body was like underneath it. Again, individual sleeping heads. And sometimes with their mouths open, as with this one. What I was trying to show was my reaction to this dramatic suspense. And this was like the early Greek drama. It's the situation that you get of a tension between people and something about an impending disaster, impending doom. There's a drama in silence more than in shouting. It reminded me sometimes, of the feeling I'd had as a student on the travelling scholarship in Italy when I discovered Masaccio. Because the Masaccio tribute money, one of the greatest and most dramatic pictures in the world, nothing is happening except the middle two figures, one handing the money as tribute. And it's not action that gives drama. It's a tension, it's getting some sense of things could happen.
Looking at these sleepers, I wonder whether great art can ever be entirely new. Moore's images link back directly to a masterpiece from the Renaissance, a religious painting by Mantegna, The Agony in the Garden. Later in the war, Moore returned to his birthplace to study the miners working the pit at Castleford in Yorkshire.
To begin with, it seemed to me just like worse than Dante's hell to go down and be. And when eventually, after about 4 hours of seeing everything and crawling to the coalface, I thought this is really the most terrible kind of environment and situation. But at the end of the fortnight, I could take it just as easily as anybody else. For me, there were two problems. One, that they were all male figures, and I prefer female figures. I like women more than men. And also, too, in my sculpture, I don't like making figures jump off their pedestal. I don't like action. And here was physical action going on. But after a time, I got a bit used to it. And it posed a problem too in drawing, but I'm glad about it now, because you didn't see anything 3 yards away from you. The miner's lamp will penetrate only about, 2 or 3 yards into the darkness, pitch darkness. And with the coal machines cutting machines going, the dust, the air is full of dust. So there's a kind of mysterious glare, and you see a figure coming toward you, first by the little headlamp. Afterwards, you begin to see that it is a person, and you can recognize the face and the nose. And the eyes of the miners are all the only part that's white. They glare nearly as much as they, because the miner, with the wetness of tears, keeps his eyes clear, as in these. Now, this is also something. It shows what, I mean, Surah came into my mind, but also came into my mind Masaccio. And there, the eyes in the Masaccio painting to the tribute money, the whites of the eyes are always whiter in tone value than any other part of the picture. And this was so in the coal mines, with the miners. But it also led me to look again at Surah drawings, and led to my love of Surah.
After the war, Moore made less and less use of drawing as a way of defining sculpture. He preferred working from small models, which he could view from every side. His graphic work began to have a mysterious existence of its own, as though some kind of theatrical drama might be taking shape in his mind. His figures began to inhabit specific places. A figure in the foreground would echo the shape of a rock behind. Sometimes, groups of figures, one could hardly call them recognizable individuals, gathered like guardians or judges in front of what appear to be temples or prehistoric monuments. Sometimes they stand motionless and apart, yet alert, within walls suggesting the chambers of a tomb. Later, and by complete contrast, a few seemingly random strokes of the pen or brush were enough to form dramatic images of storms, of shipwrecks, or other poetic and wholly imaginary scenes. Other things came from the countryside, near his home. They were much more descriptive and realistic. Sheep were a favourite subject, drawn with a ballpoint pen, from which Moore could extract a line as delicate and tense as a watch spring. And he could weave this line into amazing patterns. With an etching needle, he could reproduce some of these drawings as prints with remarkable accuracy. Between two of the fields where he sometimes shows his sculptures, there's a hedgerow which must be several hundreds of years old. Farmers have cut it back to the stumps for generations. Yet the trees survive in obstinate and tenacious forms. Moore has drawn a number of these using ink on blotting paper.
Lately, I've been drawing trees because the trunks of trees are remarkably like human figures. And here are some of the trees, I think, that we looked at, yon between the two fields, and these struggling trees that have been chopped down and then regrown. And they're like, look at that, it's like a, and it's drawn from nature. It's like a figure on a crucifix upside down, as though falling. And, I mean, tree trunks are human almost. Again, I do a close-up. This, to me, is like a, like a knuckle or a knee or a breast, but there is the solidity and the body, the meat in it. And here we're just drawing the trunk and the kind of mother and child, or the big and the small, the big trunk and then the ivy growing up it. I think if I were an educationalist, I'd suggest that drawing should be made much more necessary or regular in schools, not because you're trying to make a nation of painters or sculptors or artists, but only because you teach grammar and literature, not because you're trying to make another lot of Shakespeare's, but to make them understand and use language. Well, in the same way, I think drawing is a tremendous eye-opener to people, and it would make their lives much richer. I think that if I'm looking, this sketchbook I think I had in Italy, and that's after going to one of the museums. I think it's some hands in an old master. And that may have led me on, after seeing those hands, of doing my own hands, which, again, is to understand hands I've always been fascinated by. For example, you see these, that begins it. I mean, those are my own hands held like that. That's it, that goes in there. And I can hold them like that, and I can draw this hand here, then I put this one back. It's a, it makes you look, drawing from nature, makes you look much more intensely at whatever you're drawing, more than if you just look and think you understand it. You have to really give a terrific intensity of observation. This is the last year or two, when I began the, and the note must refer to that, of figures in landscape. That is, female figures, because it's the two things together that I love, which is landscape and the female figure. And here goes on. Some of these I've turned into etchings recently, but they come out different because in this it isn't so linear, but the etching is more. And this is imagining a figure in front of the sea.
In recent years, encouraged by publishers, printers and craftsmen, Moore has become increasingly interested in various methods of printmaking. Engraving techniques had never appealed to him, but various forms of etching and lithography did. He exploited their characteristics without losing the freedom and spontaneity of his drawings. His understanding of these techniques has become so refined that it's difficult for a layman to tell the difference between his original drawing and the print.
That was the first one,
which
you had with watercolour brush and stuff.
Yes.
Then we did that one.
Yes.
It was all too hard everywhere.
I know, and it's got this sharp and that's the...
So then we got down to that.
Which is better.
Yeah.
Better.
Moore works closely on the various states of his etchings and aquatints with Alistair Grant, who heads a department of graphic design at the Royal College of Art in London. Moore likes working relationships, which leave him free to assess the development of his ideas, but which relieve him of the time-consuming process of doing the actual printing himself.
But we can get the line plane back easily. And
well, then... I think then I can get this right. Now, what happened here?
That line's been added.
It's got deeper blacks. That's right. Just a little touch in there. This we may, this may not be necessary to redraw.
I think that one's come
to redraw, to re-etch.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think it may not be necessary. I'd say that's practically all right, except for touching that bit. Can we try it up here?
Well, I can see it from a distance slightly.
Now why I began to like etching and lithography is that you can make changes without losing the original. This is the advantage now that with a drawing, if you change the drawing and put extra colour onto it or make it blacker, you can't go back to what you were before. Whereas with lithography, you can have three or four plates because you get the colour by printing one plate on top of another. And if you want to change the colour that you ink this plate with, that's going to be printed on your key figure, you can change it any number of times.
Modern lithography is an ideal way of putting images and colours one upon the other. Some of Moore's lithographs may be printed from eight or more separate plates. Their images are superimposed in a carefully calculated order on the paper, in a series of printings. All kinds of different effects can be tried out on trial proofs before the artist chooses the version which most exactly expresses his intentions. Moore has developed a whole new range of lithographic techniques, been described as sculpting on paper. In doing this, he's often been guided by the expertise of Stanley Jones, the artistic director of Kirwan Prince in London.
This is the original drawing that Moore has put on transferred paper. And from this, we transfer the images in different stages to lithographic plate. The plate is made by exposing the drawing to varying degrees of ultraviolet light, and after chemical processing, revealing the image on the lithographic surface. The next stage is where we establish the ink attracting ground on which the color will be printed. This ink helps to form the basis of the drawing on the plate. At this point also, you can make corrections by taking work out, which is not necessary to the print. You see here the first proof with the three reclining figures on one sheet of paper. And this was taken down to Match Haddam for Henry to look at. Subsequently, his idea changed and he decided to isolate the background figure against a different type of textured background activity. And you see here the composition in layers of transfer film against which the image subsequently was printed in this particular composition. This is the reclining figure, of course, for the 20th century magazine. Mm-hmm. And what we have to do in this is to ascertain the border measurements so that the sheet can be torn down for final signing.
Now, we want 57 centimetres in length, 43 in height. There. It's a bit too much, David, I think. I think there's a bit too much on the bottom.
Probably come up a little bit.
But there, I think that's nicer, if that's the right measurement. Just want to go up.
I've got to lose half a centimetre.
From where?
Well, from either.
Well, it doesn't matter.
Want to come up?
Just a fraction, that's it.
That's 43.
That's it. I think that proportion's perfectly all right. And when it's signed and with the lettering underneath it, it'll be...
We have 8.5.
Perfect.
8.5.
Yeah.
Could he pass me the other one? This one?
If he can put good for margins on it.
Yes, as well.
Can you put good for margins on it as well, please?
I can't. It's not so easy to write when you're strung up from the ceiling. This is the opposite. Michelangelo painted the Sistine Chapel. Is that? Right.
Thank you.
So in recent years, Moore has used graphic techniques as a way of keeping pace with the stream of ideas that appear in his sketchbooks and drawings. The themes that sustain his sculpture are reinterpreted on paper and given a new life of their own. Has been drawing and making sculpture out of the human form for 60 years. The shape and feel of our own physical existence is for him a subject without end.
You see, I came at a time when for whole generations, for 300 to 400 years, art had been based completely on the Renaissance and on Greek. Now, just before me, artists such as Picasso and Derain and Modigliani and Epstein and so on were discovering that there was a lot of art in the world, sculpture in the world, which was not classical and not Greek and Renaissance. And the whole of the world was open to me when I came to London. There was the British Museum with sculpture from 30,000 BC, the Paleolithic period, right through to Negro and Mexican and the whole of the primitive, so-called primitive period. This gave a whole new possibilities to sculpture. We all have to learn from the past. And I hope I go on learning still.
In 1977, Moore became a grandfather. His daughter Mary had a son, and these are some of Moore's drawings of him.
All of us, we live on what you learn from the past and what you give and what you find by observation of life and reality in front of you. And you can't do one without the other, in my opinion.